Directions to a tourist to the Museum of Natural History, Mark would shout after them, "Good luck!" And I said, Mark, you're giving out a Congress a lopsided impression of New Yorkers. But the reason we're all here this afternoon in this beautiful and historic theater isn't just to remember someone for being nice. That would really send out a lopsided message about New Yorkers. I think it was because Mark, Mark's unusual and compelling combination of artistic powers, personal oddities, and lovable spirit. Mark O'Donnell, the writer, wasn't contentious or pretentious enough to be a real literary liar. I would say he was more of a literary otter, loopily playing in his corner of the cultural woods. Mark produced several novels, many full-length plays, numerous one-acts, hundreds of cartoons, and a myriad of poems and songs. Serious, half-serious, silly, and often serious and silly at the same time. He even wrote a spoken narration to an orchestral piece called Pyramus and Thisbe. He translated works from the French. This could frustrate some editors or some agents. Mark didn't just work on Broadway musicals, he wrote haiku. How do you label, how do you present such a slippery, silly otter? Mark sometimes wasted his efforts beautifully. When his first novel, Getting Over Homer, came out, I was so proud. I was at a Barnes & Noble just browsing, and I saw a big display, stacks of them, with a sign that said, autographed by the author. So I opened the top one on the top stack. Mark had neatly written, "Don't tell the others, but you're my favorite reader." I grabbed another one from the pile next to it, and it was inscribed, "Look for a veiled reference to you on page 1." And then, in kind of success, I grabbed one from the back pile, deep in the pile, and it said, "Please don't use my signature to forge checks." Oh, he didn't have to do that. He didn't have to write them all different, but maybe in a way he did have to, for his own inner satisfaction. Routinely, Mark made things up to amuse a non-existent audience. I'd grab a pack of matches off his kitchen counter to light a cigarette, and I'd suddenly notice it was a blank one on which he doodled, "Look, club stupid." As I cleaned out his house these past couple weeks, I kept finding hilarious things like that. On the floor of his closet, a torn index card with some kind of shower curtain ring taped to it with a little Bic pen notation on the side, "Halo for a Barbie doll?" And who was that for? Like finding the bulging manila envelope he kept full of scraps of paper with his friends' phone numbers and addresses on. One of them was labeled gay. And then in parentheses, "But so much more than that." For Mark, being a bohemian bishop with many multiple creative aspects was innate, always. I know. I was there from the get-go. I'm Mark's identical twin. We were co-zygotes, co-protoplasm, companions in the cradle and best friends for life. And yet, even though I'm genetically like Mark, and even though for years we could swap classes and take tests for each other, there wasn't and isn't anybody even close to being like Mark. His astounding quickness and spontaneous polish were there from earliest childhood. I'm technically the older twin, having been born 5 minutes before Mark. So sometime in grade school, it occurred to me to joke, "I'm the original Mark, and you're the copy." Mark came back right away with, "No, you're the rough draft, and I'm the new improvement." My friend Ed Strassner once said of grown-up Mark, "He's like a Zen master who still has puppy mind." And those of you who are lucky enough to have been close to Mark recognize this. He was like a big kid, a big child. But when he actually technically truly was a child, he was preternaturally mature, precocious, I'd say he was an old soul if the old soul you were talking about was Lewis Carroll or Edward Lear or Dr. Seuss. How did he land in the family that he did? There was a degree of goofy destiny there. He was the 10th of 10 children, like a character in some weird folktale. Five brothers, five sisters, five left-handed like Mark, five right-handed like me. Half fair-eyed like my dad, half dark-eyed like my mom. Mark attributed this strange manifestation of genetic principles to the fact that our parents ate a lot of day-old bread. Dad and Mom, a Cleveland welder and a homemaker, that's respectively, must have scratched their heads more than once over the little oddball who wrapped up their production line of progeny. Who was this Crayola-clutching changeling who, in elementary school, was cranking out books of his own, written on manila paper, stapled together with anglophilic titles like The Uncanny Adventures of Percy the Kitten, and Golden Tales from Arthurian Mythology. Atop the kitchen table, when he was free, Mark wrote and illustrated his own series of books, the Animal Land stories, the Mousy books, Mousy's House, Mousy's Party, Mousy and his Dad, etc., still not in print. And on the back cover, he carefully printed, "Do you have these other books by Mark?" The inside cover of the books had a little square. You could fill it. This book belongs to blank. And maybe my sister Maureen or my sister Christine would gamely print their name there just to humor our prolific midget missionary. What inspired Mark? I'm not sure. There weren't many books in our house. The Funk and Wagnalls medical advisor, cheaper than a doctor, and the Bible, which, as Catholics, we never read. No, Mark seems self-invented, or another byproduct of day-old bread. Here's a question for sociologists and biologists. We grew up in a blue-collar neighborhood. The dads up and down 95th Street, and a mom here and there, worked at Republic Steel, Sherwin-Williams, or the Fisher Body Plant. Yet here, with no role model, and way before the internet, was 10-year-old Mark O'Donnell spending his paper route money on Broadway show records. Something in him wanted that. He was impressive in his devotion, even to the more obscure of these musicals, all of which he knew by heart, as did I by osmosis. Stop the World, I Want to Get Off, Baker Street, Gigi, the one and only original family band. Even as an embryonic gay, Mark was in a category of all his own. His encyclopedic knowledge and refined discernment was evident even as we watched TV. The other brothers and sisters would sit stunned as Mark spotted those tertiary character actors as they came and went on our black and white screen. There's Grady Sutton. That's Lyle Becker. Andrew Duggan again. He's always a general or something. Carl Valentine is so funny. And all of Alice Gosley. I love her. Mark's eccentric braininess could have gotten him beat up a lot. But I'm happy to say he only got beat up a little. Even the toughest pocket knife carrying bullies in our neighborhood got a kick out of Mark's repertoire of jokes, which were decidedly superior to those in our weekly reader. We all sense Mark had an unusual, magical seeming aura. The 10 to 10 kids, a twin, the kid who knew his Academy Award winners the way the rest of us knew the Cleveland Indians lineup. Sometimes, some combination of the five brothers would go fishing together. Mark identified his status here as low man on the scrotum pole. On one of these fishing trips, we caught a toad, and we brought the toad home as a pet. Within a week, Mark had filled three spiral notebooks with a musical about toads that he called West Side Forest. The big opening and closing number, tadpoles are busting out all over. In high school, unprecedentedly, Mark got to skip writing a term paper for our European history class. Instead, he wrote a musical version of European history. He got the class to sing along on This Is Number number about Joan of Arc. I'm getting murdered in the morning. I'm going to the shine. So roll up the matches and strike up the matches. But for God's sake, take me into church sometime. He also had Louis XIV singing, I'm strictly sovereign, sovereign. Mark was viewed more as a wondrous curiosity than a most likely to succeed type, though he was worried at in ninth grade. He was imaginative enough to be anti-imaginative on occasion. I sat between him and Arlene Purcell in the study hall, and she sent Mark a note filled with exclamation points. Let's pretend we're spies, and we have to smuggle out a secret formula. Mark wrote back, no, let's pretend we're the offspring of mill workers exchanging notes in a rusting northern Midwest industrial city. It is both a delight and a bummer at the same time. When graduation time came, I remember Evie Copan daunted, asking Mark, what should I write on my little wallet-sized photo of you? And Mark, so sophisticated, said, oh, just inscribe it to Mark with his elephant charm. And Evie wrote, to Mark with his elephant charm. She did not know from elephant. Well, Mark kept his elephant charm into our middle age. Always he was otherworldly. He loved that line from Thornton Wilder's Archon about whether anybody ever really appreciates life while they're living it. Saints and poets, they do. Some. Well, Mark was sort of a saint, and he positively was a poet. He won a Tony Award, got a Guggenheim Fellowship, he wrote on Saturday Night Live, yet to my certain knowledge, he owned one belt. He gave generously to charities like Doctors Without Borders, yet would still phone me excitedly to say he'd spotted a half gallon of milk on sale for $2.99 at CVS. Many of you have multiple stories of when Mark would drop whatever he was doing and walk and talk with you and help you through your ups and downs. He was always, always a caring friend that way, encouraging, appreciative of the good qualities in others. He was extraordinarily conscientious about remembering birthdays. Even for our dozens and dozens of nieces and nephews, this was another way in which he made me look like crap. And if you knew him, you know he wasn't using a computer program, but rather a heavily notated old school calendar, probably from some insurance company or hardware store. He gave great gifts, a sign of his big heart and his big mind. I glance around my apartment now, and there is the statue of, from Red China of Mao smoking a cigarette. My program from the all-Japanese production of Abe Lincoln in Illinois. My yard-long model of the Nautilus from Disney's 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea. Perfect for me, but more perfect from him. I often wondered about Mark's gifts to the Hairspray cast members who he came to love. They were like a second family to him. What did that actress make of the article from the 1920s Reader's Digest headed, don't become an actress. So the kid dancer who got a shred of an old Depression era magazine ad proclaiming, gee ma, these nose drops are swell. Well, I presume they loved Mark, and they must have seen that those things were very, very Markish. Mark's kindness seems even more valuable when put in perspective with his own ups and downs, for he had his own problems and he had his own demons. Loneliness, despite the many, many, many people who love, love, love him. I guess that's not an unknown problem in a single artistic soul. He struggled with alcohol too, also not an unknown affliction in a writer. And even in that way, he was more of a heedless child than a hardened user. Mark could be a weird blend of St. Francis of Assisi, Oscar Wilde, and sometimes a little bit of Crazy Guggenheim. But what a writer. Here are seven syllables from one of Mark's short poems he called Manhattan Zen. They were haiku short. They distilled moments of life in New York City, and this is one of my favorites. A run over rat. Good. Still. Mark loved the song Stranger on Earth, which we might hear a little bit later, especially sung by Dinah Washington. I think he may have identified a little bit with the lyrics about being a stranger on Earth, but in that he escaped a fate. He was not like everyone else. They say the good die young, and maybe the mostly good, like Mark, just die prematurely. I certainly did not want to lose him this soon, or ever, and I ache so much when I'm walking on Upper Broadway and I'm hoping to see him coming towards me. But what I increasingly feel is happiness at my good fortune to have been the guy's twin and to have the family and friends that we share. We can all have ongoing joy and laughter remembering Mark, quoting his comments, recalling his adorably strange way of doing things. I mentioned Mark giving directions to tourists at the top of his remarks, and I was at his side once in the village when an out-of-towner asked where Bleaker was. Mark instantly replied, between Bleak and Bleakest.
Someone who understood how to adapt material but could make something brand new. The idea for Mark came from my pal John Lohr, the New Yorker critic, and it was truly an inspired one. After proper due diligence, I read a lot of Mark's work, but if I had seen those cartoons, I wouldn't have read any further. I would have just called him up. I grabbed onto it. He jumped at the chance and made the trip to California to meet with Mark and Scott, who were all ready to go. I have no idea, even though I've asked several times, what went on in that first meeting or those first few days in Southern California. But as all things Hairspray, it was clearly blessed, and the rest is history. A couple of moments in that history capture my experience of Mark as a man. The first was when we needed a way for Mark and
I'm not sure. There weren't many books in our house. The funded Wagnalls medical advisor, cheaper than a doctor. And the Bible, which, as Catholics, we never read. No, Mark seems self-invented, or another byproduct of day-old bread. Here's a question for sociologists and biologists. We grew up in a blue-collar neighborhood. The dads up and down 95th Street, and a mom here and there, worked at Republic Steel, Sherwin-Williams, or the Fisher Body Plant. Yet here, with no role model, and way before the internet, was 10-year-old Mark O'Donnell spending his paper route money on Broadway show records. Something in him wanted that. He was impressive in his devotion, even to the more obscure of these musicals, all of which he knew by heart, as did I by osmosis. Stop the World, I Want to Get Off, Baker Street, Gigi, the one and only original family band. Even as an embryonic gay, Mark was in a category of all his own. His encyclopedic knowledge and refined discernment was evident even as we watched TV. The other brothers and sisters would sit stunned as Mark spotted the most tertiary character actors as they came and went on our black and white screen. There's Grady Sutton. That's Lyle Becker. Andrew Duggan again, he's always a general or something. Carl Valentine is so funny. And oh, Alice Mosley, I love her. Mark's eccentric braininess could have gotten him beat up a lot. But I'm happy to say he only got beat up a little. Even the toughest pocket knife carrying bullies in our neighborhood got a kick out of Mark's repertoire of jokes. Which were decidedly superior to those in our weekly reader. We all sensed Mark had an unusual, magical-seeming aura. The 10 to 10 kids, a twin, the kid who knew his Academy Award winners the way the rest of us knew the Cleveland Indians lineup. Sometimes, some combination of the five brothers would go fishing together. Mark identified his status here as low man on the scrotum pole. We caught a toad, and we brought the toad home as a pet. Within a week, Mark had filled three spiral notebooks with a musical about toads that he called West Side Forest. The big opening and closing number, tadpoles are busted out all over. In high school, unprecedentedly, Mark got to skip writing a term paper for our European history class. Instead, he wrote a musical version of European history. He got the class to sing along on this, his number about Joan of Arc. I'm getting murdered in the morning. I'm going closer to the shine. So roll up the patches and strike up the matches. But for God's sake, take me into church sometime. He also had Louis XIV singing, I'm strictly the sovereign, sovereign. Mark was viewed more as a wondrous curiosity than a most likely to succeed type, though he was voted that in ninth grade. He was imaginative enough to be anti-imaginative on occasion. I sat between him and Arlene Purcell in a study hall, and she sent Mark a note filled with exclamation points. Let's pretend we're spies, and we have to smuggle out a secret formula. Mark wrote back, no, let's pretend we're the offspring of mill workers exchanging notes in a rusting northern Midwest industrial city. It was both a delight and a bummer at the same time. When graduation time came, I remember Evie Copan, daunted, said, "Oh, just inscribe it to Mark with his elephant charm." And Emmy wrote, "To Mark with his elephant charm." She did not know from elephant charm. Well, Mark kept his elephant charm into our middle age. Always he was otherworldly. He loved that line from Thornton Wilder's Archon about whether anybody ever really appreciates life while they're living it. Saints and poets, they do, some. Well, Mark was sort of a saint, and he positively was a poet. He won a Tony Award, got a Guggenheim Fellowship, he wrote on Saturday Night Live, yet to my certain knowledge, he owned one belt. He gave generously to charities like Doctors Without Borders, yet would still phone me excitedly to say he'd spotted a half gallon of milk on sale for $2.99 at CVS. Many of you have multiple stories of when Mark would drop whatever he was doing and walk and talk with you and help you through your ups and downs. He was always, always a caring friend that way, encouraging, appreciative of the good qualities in others. He was extraordinarily conscientious about remembering birthdays, even for our dozens and dozens of nieces and nephews. This was another way in which he made me look like crap. And if you knew him, you know he wasn't using a computer program, but rather a heavily notated old school calendar, probably from some insurance company or hardware store. He gave great gifts, a sign of his big heart and his big mind. I glance around my apartment now, and there is the statue of, from Red China of Mao smoking a cigarette. My program from the all-Japanese production of Abe Lincoln in Illinois. My yard-long model of the Nautilus from Disney's 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea. Perfect for me, but more perfect from him. I often wondered about Mark's gifts to the Hairspray cast members who he came to love. They were like a second family to him. What did that actress make of the article from the 1920s Reader's Digest headed, "Don't Become an Actress"? So the kid dancer who got a shred of an old Depression era magazine ad proclaiming, "Gee, Ma, these nose drops are swell." Well, I presume they loved Mark, and they must have seen that those things were very, very Markish. Mark's kindness seems even more valuable when put in perspective with his own ups and downs, for he had his own problems and he had his own demons. Loneliness, despite the many, many, many people who love, love, love him. I guess that's not an unknown problem in a single artistic soul. He struggled with alcohol too, also not an unknown affliction in a writer. And even in that way, he was more of a heedless child than a hardened user. Mark could be a weird blend of St. Francis of Assisi, Oscar Wilde, and sometimes a little bit of Crazy Guggenheim. But what a writer. Here are seven syllables from one of Mark's short poems he called Manhattan Zen. They were haiku short. They distilled moments of life in New York City. And this is one of my favorites. "A run over rat. Good. Still." Mark loved the song "Stranger on Earth," which we might hear a little bit later, especially sung by Dinah Washington. I think he may have identified a little bit with the lyrics about being a stranger on Earth, but in that he escaped the fate. He was not like everyone else. They say the good die young, and maybe the mostly good, like Mark, just die prematurely. I certainly did not want to lose him this soon, or ever, and I ache so much when I'm walking on Upper Broadway and I'm hoping to see him coming towards me. But what I increasingly feel is happiness at my good fortune to have been the guy's twin and to have the family and friends that we share. We can all have ongoing joy and laughter remembering Mark, quoting his comments, recalling his adorably strange way of doing things. I mentioned Mark giving directions to tourists at the top of his remarks. And I was at his side once in the village when an out-of-towner asked where Bleecker was. Mark instantly replied, "Between Bleak and Bleakus."
Thank you.
His outlook was always positive, engaged, full of wonder. His humor never mean-spirited, though it could be wickedly witty. My family and I have heard from so many of Mark's friends, his writing students, his Broadway collaborators, all with such lovely things to share. For us, for Mark, thank you. I want to just offer two last tidbits from Mark O'Donnell, an epigram and another Manhattan Zen. The epigram seems custom made for the occasion. The unlived life is not worth examining. And a parting New York image. At the end of every block, a sliver of sunset. Mark, I'll be seeing you in many sunsets, full of love and gratitude. You remind all of us that humor and poetry can make being alive bearable. Thanks.
He's here in spirit and happy, I know, for all of us, for that joy. When a book writer signs on to a musical, he may be taking his ego, sanity, and career, if not his life, into his own hands. If the show's a hit, 9 out of 10 times, the attention goes to the actors, the directors, the choreographers, the composers, and the lyricists, with only sometimes a brief tip of the hat to the book writer. But if the show is a flop, well, 9 out of 10 times, guess who gets the blame? It takes one stout, bright soul to sign on to this role, and most importantly, to find the moxie to fight for his voice, all the while building the scaffolding that keeps the whole shebang together. Mark was that brave soul, and he was a lot more. He was a total original. That may be redundant. I'm sorry, Steve, if that's okay. Mark. The search for a book writer for Hairspray was daunting, even more than usual. I needed to find someone who could capture the uniqueness of John Waters' voice, but not imitate it. Someone who understood how to adapt material, but could make something brand new. The idea for Mark came from my pal John Lohr, the New Yorker critic, and it was truly an inspired one. After proper due diligence, I read a lot of Mark's work. If I had seen those cartoons, I wouldn't have read any further. I would have just called him up. I grabbed onto it. He jumped at the chance and made the trip to California to meet with Mark and Scott, who were all ready to go. I have no idea, even though I've asked several times, what went on in that first meeting or those first few days in Southern California. But as all things Hairspray, it was clearly blessed, and the rest is history. A couple of moments in that history capture my experience of Mark as a man. The first was when we needed a way for Mark and
I'm not sure. There weren't many books in our house, a funded Wagnalls medical advisor, cheaper than a doctor, and the Bible, which, as Catholics, we never read. No, Mark seems self-invented, or another byproduct of day-old bread. Here's a question. Sociologists and biologists. We grew up in a blue-collar neighborhood. The dads up and down 95th Street, and a mom here and there, worked at Republic Steel, Sherwin-Williams, or the Fisher Body Plant. Yet here, with no role model, and way before the internet, was 10-year-old Mark O'Donnell spending his paper route money on Broadway show records. Something in him wanted that. He was impressive in his devotion, even to the more obscure of these musicals, all of which he knew by heart, as did I. Stop the World, I Want to Get Off, Baker Street, Gigi, the one and only original family band. Even as an embryonic gay, Mark was in a category of all his own. His encyclopedic knowledge and refined discernment was evident even as we watched TV. The other brothers and sisters would sit stunned as Mark spotted the most tertiary character actors as they came and went on our black and white screen. There's Grady Sutton. That's Lyle Becker. Andrew Duggan again, he's always a general or something. Carl Valentine is so funny. And Paul Alice Gossey, I love her. Mark's eccentric braininess could have gotten him beat up a lot. But I'm happy to say he only got beat up a little. Even the toughest pocket knife carrying bullies in our neighborhood got a kick out of Mark's repertoire of jokes, which were decidedly superior to those in our Weekly Reader. We all sensed Mark had an unusual, magical-seeming aura. The 10th of 10 kids, a twin, the kid who knew his Academy Award winners the way the rest of us knew the Cleveland Indians lineup. Sometimes, some combination of the five brothers would go fishing together. Mark identified his status here as low man on the scrotum pole. On one of these fishing trips, we caught a toad, and we brought the toad home as a pet. Within a week, Mark had filled three spiral notebooks with a musical about toads that he called West Side Forest. The big opening and closing number, tadpoles are busted out all over. In high school, unprecedentedly, Mark got to skip writing a term paper for our European history class. Instead, he wrote a musical version of European history. He got the class to sing along on this, his number about Joan of Arc. I'm getting murdered in the morning. I'm going to go to the China. So roll up the matches and strike up the matches. But for God's sake, take me into church sometime. He also had Louis XIV singing, I'm strictly the sovereign, sovereign. Mark was viewed more as a wondrous curiosity than a most likely to succeed type, though he was voted that in ninth grade. He was imaginative enough to be anti-imaginative on occasion. I sat between him and Arlene Purcell in the study hall, and she sent Mark a note filled with exclamation points. Let's pretend we're spies, and we have to smuggle out a secret formula. Mark wrote back, no, let's pretend we're the offspring of mill workers exchanging notes in a rusting northern Midwest industrial city. It is both a delight and a bummer at the same time. When graduation time came, I remember Evie Copan daunted, asking Mark, what should I write on my little wallet-sized photo of you? And Mark, so sophisticated, said, oh, just inscribe it to Mark with his elephant charm. And Emmy wrote, to Mark with his elephant charm. She did not know from elephant charm. Well, Mark kept his elephant charm into our middle age. Always he was otherworldly. He loved that line from Thornton Wilder's Archon about whether anybody ever really appreciates life while they're living it. Saints and poets, they do. Some. Well, Mark was sort of a saint, and he positively was a poet. He won a Tony Award, got a Guggenheim Fellowship, he wrote on Saturday Night Live, yet to my certain knowledge, he owned one belt. He gave generously to charities like Doctors Without Borders, yet would still phone me excitedly to say he'd spotted a half gallon of milk on sale for $2.99 at CVS. Many of you have multiple stories of when Mark would drop whatever he was doing and walk and talk with you and help you through your ups and downs. He was always, always a caring friend that way, encouraging, appreciative of the good qualities in others. He was extraordinarily conscientious about remembering birthdays, even for our dozens and dozens of nieces and nephews. This was another way in which he made me look like crap. And if you knew him, you know he wasn't using a computer program, but rather a heavily notated old school calendar, probably from some insurance company or hardware store. He gave great gifts, a sign of his big heart and his big mind. I glance around my apartment buildings. There is a statue from Red China of Mao smoking a cigarette. My program from the all-Japanese production of Abe Lincoln in Illinois. My yard-long model of the Nautilus from Disney's 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea. Perfect for me, but more perfect from him. I often wondered about Mark's gifts to the Hairspray cast members who he came to love. They were like a second family to him. What did that actress make of the article from the 1920s Reader's Digest headed, "Don't Become an Actress"? The kid dancer who got a shred of an old Depression era magazine ad proclaiming, "Gee, Ma, these nose drops are swell." Well, I presume they loved Mark, and they must have seen that those things were very, very Markish. Mark's kindness seems even more valuable when put in perspective with his own ups and downs, for he had his own problems and he had his own demons. Loneliness, despite the many, many, many people who love him. I guess that's not an unknown problem in a single artistic soul. He struggled with alcohol, too, also not an unknown affliction in a writer. And even in that way, he was more of a heedless child than a hardened user. Mark could be a weird blend of St. Francis of Assisi, Oscar Wilde, and sometimes a little bit of Crazy Guggenheim. But what a writer. Here are seven syllables from one of Mark's short poems he called Manhattan Zen. They were haiku short. They distilled moments of life in New York City. And this is one of my favorites. A run over rat. Good. Still. Mark loved the song Stranger on Earth, which we might hear a little bit later, especially sung by Dinah Washington. I think he may have identified a little bit with the lyrics about being a stranger on Earth, but in that he escaped the fate. He was not like everyone else. They say the good die young, and maybe the mostly good, like Mark, just die prematurely. I certainly did not want to lose him this soon, or ever, and I ache so much when I'm walking on Upper Broadway and I'm hoping to see him coming towards me. But what I increasingly feel is happiness at my good fortune to have been the guy's twin and to have the family and friends that we share. We can all have ongoing joy and laughter remembering Mark, quoting his comments, recalling his adorably strange way of doing things. I mentioned Mark giving directions to tourists at the top of these remarks. And I was at his side once in the village when an out-of-towner asked where Bleecker was. Mark instantly replied, "Between Bleak and Bleakest."
Thanks.
listening to school, seeing the cartoons and listening to Steve, to follow two O'Donnells is really a stupefying and terrifying event. But I'm so happy to hear the joy in the audience and to have seen downstairs the celebration of the Hairspray cast and company, and I know that's what Mark would have wanted. It's, of course, not the occasion we want that to be, but he's here in spirit and happy, I know, for all of us, for that joy. When a book writer signs on to a musical, he may be taking his ego, sanity, and career, if not his life, into his own hands. If the show's a hit, 9 out of 10 times, the attention goes to the actors, the directors, the choreographers, the composers, and the lyricists, with only sometimes a brief tip of the hat to the book writer. But if the show is a flop, well, 9 out of 10 times, guess who gets the blame? It takes one stout, bright soul to sign on to this role, and most importantly, to find the moxie to fight for his voice, all the while building the scaffolding that keeps the whole shebang together. Mark was that brave soul, and he was a lot more. He was a total original. That may be redundant. I'm sorry, Steve, if that's okay. And Mark. The search for a book writer for Hairspray was daunting, even more than usual. I needed to find someone who could capture the uniqueness of John Waters' voice, but not imitate it. Someone who understood how to adapt material, but could make something brand new. The idea for Mark came from my pal John Lohr, the New Yorker critic, and it was truly an inspired one. After proper due diligence, I read a lot of Mark's work, but if I had seen those cartoons, I wouldn't have read any further. I would have just called him up. I grabbed onto it. He jumped at the chance and made the trip to California to meet with Mark and Scott, who were all ready to go. I have no idea, even though I've asked several times, what went on in that first meeting or those first few days in Southern California. But as all things Hairspray, it was clearly blessed, and the rest is history. A couple of moments in that history capture my experience of Mark as a man. The first was when we needed a way for Mark and Scott, who were in California, to work with Mark here in town. So just to show you how long ago this was, I suggested to Mark that he used his fax machine. There was a long silence. He's gobsmacked when Mark sheepishly revealed that he didn't have a fax machine and would have no idea how to work one if he did. So I figured, oh, this guy really is a stranger on this earth. And as I remember, we bought him a fax machine and we sent somebody up to tell him how to work it. I guess I'd have to ask Mark whether he actually ever did work, but at least it was there. The most indelible memory I have of Mark in our roles as producer and writer was that moment that I phoned him to say that Tom Meehan would be coming on to help with the book. Bringing someone else on, in quotes, are among the most dreaded words a writer or artist can hear, and certainly for a producer to utter. I steeled myself for the worst. As expected, Mark was angry, really angry. Well, Mark's kind of anger, which was more like indignant. And he had some pretty tough words for me. I felt lousy. But here's the thing. It wasn't more than a minute or two before my phone rang after we hung up, and Mark again was on the other end of the line. "I don't know how I could have spoken to you like I did," he said. "You've given me a chance of a lifetime, and I'm incredibly grateful. I'll be happy to meet with Tom anytime." I have to say that I have told this story innumerable times to young writers who I teach, and hope they will take heed, because it was a remarkable gesture on his part. That was the essence of Mark, a generous, thoughtful, chivalrous even man, who in his very being captured the spirit of a big-hearted story of acceptance, inclusion, and the yearning that we all have to belong. His relationship with Tom Meehan blossomed into an ongoing professional partnership and a deep personal friendship. Tom couldn't be here today. He's in Germany with Rocky, but he sent some remarks which I'd like to read to you. As all of us here know, Mark was a singular soul, profoundly intelligent, funny, thoughtful, and once again, a total original. To my mind, these are mine. Forget these remarks. That was the first part of when I was writing this down. So now let's rewind. Mark loved to smile, especially when we were working together, and he was about to come out with yet another of his astonishing zingers. Working with Mark as we tried to top each other's lines was an endless pleasure, and we promised each other that following Hairspray and Crybaby, we'd someday write another show together. It's close to heartbreaking to realize that that can never happen. Life, as I guess we've all by this time discovered, isn't fair. Certainly, according to the actuarial tables, an aged geezer such as I should have shuffled off this mortal coil years before Mark so abruptly left us. And he should have been standing here saying, I hope, a few reasonably pleasant things about me, rather than these words of mine in praise of him. Anyway, I'm sure that he could have written something far wittier for the occasion, but I think not more heartfelt. Mark finally was one of the two or three most generous and thoughtful persons I'd ever known. And for instance, he would always remember my birthday, even when myself, I had almost forgotten it, calling to wish me a happy birthday, even at times when we hadn't been in touch for 2 or 3 months. My last birthday was in mid-August, only a few days after Mark died. I sat by the phone all day, but it never rang. Goodbye, dear Mark. Now that you're here, I can already see them smiling and hear them laughing at Heaven's Gate on the far side of paradise.
Hi, I'm Patty Marks, and I knew Mark longer than I didn't know him. He was the kindest, funniest, funny person, and the funniest, kind person I have ever met. We became friends when he joined the Harvard Lampoon. I was a sophomore, already on the Lampoon, and he was a freshman. It was immediately clear to everyone that he was the most likely of us to turn into Oscar Wilde or William Shakespeare, or to be included in Bartlett's quotations. One of the Lampoon's hazing rituals of initiates involved eating some gross-looking cold eggs off the floor. It's true. All of the other newcomers were so cowed, or maybe so nauseated, they couldn't talk. But Mark, with that whispery aplomb of his, turned to the pretty girl next to him and said, "Do you come here often?" Showed up at Mark's dorm room. Apparently, in the return address on the envelope of a letter he sent his parents, he'd used the famously abducted Patty Hearst name. He must have typed the letter because nobody else in the world could have had that handwriting, with the possible exception of Steve. And they wouldn't have made up the name Patty Hearst. His handwriting looked like an artist's rendition of the New Times, of the Times New Roman font, as seen in a funhouse mirror and written with the artist's left foot. Mark was a serif, kind of guy. Mark was a star throughout college. At his graduation, he delivered the Ivy Oration. A friend of ours, Jeff Seinfeld, told me that Mark's speech was so hilarious that Art Buchwald, who was the featured speaker, laughed with enough gusto to extinguish the cigar in his mouth. Buchwald said that he considered not walking up to the podium because he didn't want to follow Mark. I can relate. I love Mark's combination of awkwardness, confidence, genius, and politeness. He lived a Beckett life and had a Beckett brain, but his presentation to the world was always feel-good Disney. Who else regularly and gallantly kissed women's hands? I also love the delighted and mildly surprised look on Mark's face when you ran into him at a party. His face lit up, and he managed to make you feel as if you were a celebrity he was ushering onto the show set. And if you said anything funny, he would tilt his head back, smile hugely, and then laugh. David Roney called it Mark's laugh light for the audience. I love his throwaway references, too. Mark once told me he had a dream about Archimedes. In the original Greek. And of course, I love his thoughtfulness and generosity. My friend Sarah Crichton tells me that when she graduated, Mark gave her a copy of The Wasteland as a field guide for life. Mark once sent me a letter on which he had attached far too much postage as a token, he said, of his love for me. After college, Mark had many critical triumphs. Books were published, off-Broadway plays were produced, and poems appeared in magazines. But for years, he never achieved the gigantic hit we all anticipated and that he deserved. Then came Hairspray. Everyone was absolutely thrilled. The system was working. I think this was the first recorded instance in New York of success not eliciting any envy or bitterness. The Germans probably have a word for that. And and Mark would know it. A few weeks ago, I came across a cartoon Mark had drawn in college depicting a man and woman holding hands on the beach at sunset. The man is cornily saying to the woman, "Today is only yesterday, a day later." Mark got that wrong. Today is plenty different than yesterday. And finally, since we're honoring Mark's life in the theater, I'd like to read two of his plays. Really, in their entirety, if you don't mind. But fear not, they are probably the world's pithiest plays. The first is called Exploration of Mars, and it goes like this. Yoo-hoo! And the second... this is a double feature. The second play I'd like to read in its entirety is The Doomed SC, and it goes like this. But I don't like that color lifeboat.
Tendency to skip large portions of the script. Inspector Billingsgate! At last you're here.
That's true. I am here.
Yes, quite here. Well, I think it's topping of you to come to our lovely summer home, which I shall inherit in the fullness of time.
Do you? Where is your only sister, Fanny?
In the garden, I expect. Though I'm so indolent and destined for a bad end, I scarcely keep track of details. Do come in.
Thank you.
Have a seat. I see you're sitting, Inspector. How elegant. A drink, perhaps? Or two at once?
You're nervous, Fenton. Do the words Millicent Espinosa mean anything to you?
No. No. Why should they?
I'm just testing you. They're nonsense words. You're quite right.
Would you care for a cigarette? Or two at once? They're here on the mantel in this silver box.
You make me laugh, Fenton.
No, you make me laugh, Inspector.
How little you've changed since your boyhood.
Time is a bitter artist, Inspector. Cigarette?
I've already said no.
No, you haven't.
Have you ever known a man named Cinnamon Boris?
Certainly not. I've never even been to that part of town.
But you know him well enough to borrow money from him.
Of him?
From him.
Ah. Really, Inspector, this is so fatiguing. This is so fatiguing.
You're complacence itself, aren't you? Even if the blue bottle fortune hangs in the balance?
I'm afraid! I can't help you, Inspector. I think you're mistaken in your suspicion.
Do you?
Yes, I do. I so very do.
That's all right. So you do, do you?
Yes, I do.
Do you?
What's in this line?
Answer me! Do you?
Yes, I do.
Do you?
As I've said, yes!
Do
want to know the truth?
Do you?
But what's this you were about to tell me, Inspector? About my sister being in grave danger?
Oh, that's right, thanks. See, that's right. Grave danger.
Danger? My Fanny in danger. I'm taken aback. Fanny! Enter, quickly! You dog. You cure.
Fenton, I've been dressing for simply hours. Kendall will be here at any moment. We're going to the sophomore ambassador's ball. Tell me, do you think the Count likes pearls on women?
Fanny. You're in no danger. You lied to me. And you didn't tell me the truth.
She's in grave danger. It's true, I did lie. I was just testing you. No, it is not Franny who is in grave danger, but her child.
Child? Franny?
I am underdone.
Franny, what? Have you and Ken each other.
He had his way with me.
You mean he worked his will upon you?
He pressed the advantage.
He led you down a path of diet.
He made a dishonest woman of me.
He enjoyed your sweet favors.
That's quite enough.
Sorry.
So you mean to say you risked the family fortune on a racehorse just to ransom Fanny's little Charlie?
You read my mind, Inspector. Like a man who has skipped many pages ahead in the script. But I say,
hand it all to Blazes. And as for you, Kendall.
Sorry. I thought I heard someone coming. Kendall, in fact. But I say,
hand it all to Blazes.
But he really those inspirations of mine had a place here on stage. And it was confirmed in a performance of the show. It took place at the end of the world. I played a Satan worshiper named Otis, who spoke only in blank verse. Or as Mark called it, Mel Blank verse. And there's a performance, my mom and dad were there, and I was out doing one of Otis's particularly plummy satanic rants. And a woman behind my mother turned to her husband and said, "I hate this play and I hate him." And that's when I knew that Mark and I were on the same page. And it is a page that I'm very proud to have shared. So this is by Mark. This is The Laws of Cartoon Motion. There are nine of them. One, any body suspended in space will remain suspended in space until made aware of its situation. Daffy Duck steps off a cliff, expecting further pasture land. He loiters in midair, soliloquizing flippantly, until he chances to look down. At this point, the familiar principle of 32 feet per second takes over. Number two, any body in motion will tend to remain in motion until solid matter intervenes suddenly. Whether shot from a cannon or in hot pursuit on foot, cartoon characters are so absolute in their momentum that only a telephone pole or an outsized boulder retards their forward motion. Absolutely. Sir Isaac Newton called this sudden termination the Stooges' surcease. Number three, any body passing through solid matter will leave a perforation conforming to its perimeter. Also called the silhouette of passage. This phenomenon is the specialty of victims of direct pressure explosions and reckless cowards who are so eager to escape that they exit directly through the wall of a house, leaving a cookie cutout perfect hole. The threat of skunks or matrimony often catalyzes this. Number four, the time required for an object to fall 20 stories is greater than or equal to the time it takes for whoever knocked it off the ledge to spiral down 20 flights to attempt to capture it unbroken. Such an object is inevitably priceless, the attempt to capture it inevitably unsuccessful. Number five, all principles of gravity are negated by fear. Psychic forces are sufficient in most bodies for a shock to propel them directly away from the surface. A spooky noise or an adversary's signature sound would induce motion upward, usually to the cradle of a chandelier, a treetop, or the crest of a flagpole. The feet of a running character or the wheels of a speeding auto need never touch the ground. Ergo, fleeing turns to flight. Number six, as speed increases, objects can be in several places at once. This is particularly true in tooth and claw fights, in which a character's head may be glimpsed emerging from a cloud of altercation at several places simultaneously. This effect is common as well among bodies that are spinning or being throttled, and simulates our own vision's trailing retention of images. A wacky character has the option of self-replication only at manic high speeds, and may ricochet off walls to achieve the velocity required for self-mass liberation. Number seven, certain bodies can pass through a solid wall painted to resemble tunnel entrances. Others cannot. The trompe-l'oeil inconsistency has baffled generations. But at least it is known that whoever paints an entrance on a wall's surface to trick an opponent will be unable to pursue him in his theoretical space. The painter is flattened against the wall when he attempts to follow into the painting. This is ultimately a problem of art, not of science. Number eight, any violent rearrangement of feline matter is impermanent. Cartoon cats possess more depth than even the traditional nine lives before. They can be sliced, splayed, accordion pleated, spindled, or disassembled, but they cannot be destroyed. After a few moments of blinking self-pity, they reinflate, elongate, snap back, or solidify. And finally, number nine, for every vengeance, there is an equal and opposite revengeance. This is the one law of animated cartoon motion that also applies to the physical world at large. For that reason, we need the relief of watching it happen to a duck instead.
His plays were too rosy on the outside,
and also sardonic and searching. Mark loved to whistle, and he loved to sing, and he thought of those activities as good ways to pass the time. A lot of us remember hanging out in his kitchen, and he'd suggest that we whistle. Or he'd suddenly say, "Let's sing." And we did. Mark was unabashedly himself, and I don't think it was always easy. He was smart and quirky and affectionate, just like his plays, and he was a loyal and kind friend. He contributed mightily to those heady early Playwrights Horizons years, and everybody loved him.
Hi, I'm Mark Brokaw. And I first came to know Mark through his writing over 20 years ago when a mutual friend shoved a large, torn plastic bag into my hand saying I really needed to know this writer. And inside were some 15 manuscripts, made up of short stories, one act's full length, a couple of them handwritten, and one of them I remember very distinctly was tied together with those twist ties that used to come on red packages. And the thing I was most struck by was, though, that they were all originals. They weren't copies. And, you know, the material was fantastic. The thing I really was struck by more at the time is I thought, what kind of guy sends out the originals of all his works to a complete stranger? And that question finally got answered fully many years later when I had the fantastic opportunity to work with him on Crybaby and found him to be an absolutely trusting, unerringly kind, wickedly droll, and totally giving collaborator. You know, the thing I was most struck by, Mark, as a collaborator, is that his demeanor was the same on the day in the rehearsal hall or in the process that represented the worst of what was happening, and as it was on the day that represented the best. And that was positive, positive, and more positive. He was, as many people have said before me, an original and unlike anyone I have ever known. You know, to me, he was a combination of a big elf, and a part overgrown gnome and part perpetually happy kid, and mostly the happy kid. And he also possessed, you know, an erudite and wicked wit, as many people have also commented on. There's one line from Mark and Tom's script of that piece that especially always made me smile. It was Mrs. Vernon Williams at the top of the second act, who was the uptight and upstanding matroness of the country club, said when she comes upon her teenage granddaughter sobbing in the throes of teenage angst, and she says to her, "Now, darling, didn't I ask you never to have problems?" I also think that I can say all the collaborators I've worked with in my life, he is the one that I never heard say an unkind word about anyone at any time. And I'm sure, like all of us, he has his own personal darkness, but I can say that that never entered the room and it never entered the work. We opened the show first in La Jolla, and it was on the night of the first preview, we were all huddled for warmth and protection at the back of the house before the curtain went up, and Mark sidled up to me with a brown plastic or a brown paper bag. It was all crumpled, and he said he'd been shopping all throughout La Jolla all day, but he couldn't find anything with director on it in any store, so this would have to do. And inside the bag was an 8-inch trophy that's in my office now, and on it is inscribed, "San Diego, best dad." And then he turned to me and very genuinely said he wanted to thank me for helping to raise our child right. And then he also right afterwards said he hoped that we would never find ourselves in court suing each other over custody. As on any show, there were many difficult times during that process, but Mark was always a face I could turn to get the reassurance to keep moving forward, to keep fighting the good fight, whatever the good fight was on that day. I have to say he was an absolute true gentleman of the theater, and I will always treasure the opportunity I had to know and to work with him.
Speeding whatever you're in.
Fire them too.
Hey, I'm Stewart. I'm host of the day.
I'm so glad Margo found him, you know? He was a huge part of the success of Hairspray the musical. Maybe he was the only one involved who never spent any of the money that he made for that musical. He was a funny man, kind man, and he put the gentle in gentleman. That's why he's so great at taking my characters and making them even funnier and more charming. He didn't have a mean bone in his body. Mark was in the trenches living through lots of awesome productions. I made both Hairspray and Crybaby with him. Out-of-town tryouts, everything, you know? And so we experienced together great success and failure, even though I love both the musicals. He always seemed calm, though, even though his complexion seemed a little rattled sometimes. He was always ready to come to a new writing solution. I mean, the words notes really didn't bother him. They didn't give him a nervous breakdown. Or maybe he was just a very good actor. I didn't know Mark in his personal life, but I know that I'm a better man in my personal life for having known him. He was part of the Broadway family that so generously adopted me during this great period of my life. So Mark, I miss you.
I send you this with wishes that I could be there with you to remember Mark.
Years ago, at the Seattle Rec, we convened to do a first read-through of Mark's short play, Marred Bliss. The play, like so much of Mark's writing, is hard to describe. It's a word play and weird, but somehow not mean-spirited, inverted take on American family drama. It takes place on a front porch. It's wickedly, classically funny. We sat in a circle and began to read. There was early laughter, a pleasing sign. The laughter built as we read, and soon it kept us from maintaining any real playing rhythm. We were in and out of character. Then after another page or so, it kept us from sitting or standing up straight. We'd go half a page and dissolve. Soon there was a circle of actors looking pleadingly at each other. Is there any way to stop laughing? I may wet my pants. What I remember, and part of what kept me from being able to pull myself together, was that Mark was not laughing. He was smiling benignly. He was happy we were laughing, but he was composed. With Mark's Irishness, there was always something Asian. He was a bit like an Asian parent who would find it unseemly to applaud his own children. He was pleased, but he didn't lose any control. Finally, the wonderful actor Bob Wright stood and suggested that his character, he was playing Jiri, the sailor, might walk like this, and he did a sort of rolling old salt walk that had a very subtle, leering quality. It was perfect, and Mark did laugh at that. I think because of someone else's thing, it wouldn't amount to self-congratulation. And with that final constraint gone, we all went down. It was hopeless. We had to pause the reading, recompose, and reconvene. Does this mean the collaboration with Mark was always smooth and completely without turf concerns? No, there is no such universe, but it was. Often, about as close to that as things can get. When our adaptation of Molière's Les Fourberies de Scapin played, our title is just Scapin, there are places within the dialogue where the laugh is dependable and durable. These are generally Mark's lines that he wrote. When a young gentleman, for instance, confesses to his servant that he's fallen in love and then impulsively got married, the servant says, "Congratulations, sir, I hear it's not so bad at first." Can build playing rhythm around that line. You can count on the moment to take a breath. The laugh is slightly delayed, and it breaks like a wave. It's a wonderful piece of craft. Editors and actors sometimes try a comma before the words "at first," but then it's not O'Donnell anymore. When the comma goes away, the motor is dependable again. There's another of Mark's lines that didn't stay in the adaptation, but it's a line that I'll never forget in delivering in a meeting one day. It's this: "I'd like to go out with you, but I have to wash my hair." It's such a comically compact vision of loneliness. We nodded to each other when he gave it. One more line of Mark's that will always be with me, I'm sure with many of us, a signature O'Donnellism. When the subject was rewrites and how they'd be handled, Mark would so often say, "Like the Coast Guard, I'm standing by."
I say not surprisingly because scattered among you are the Hairspray alum who will recognize this moment. Because at the conclusion of every rehearsal, of every run-through, Jerry and I would give our notes together, and then there would be a moment that we finally identified as either the sermon or the back to Jesus moment. And here, alas, it is. Except for real. Thinking about how I could possibly communicate to this particular assembly what I feel, I thought, well, I'll reach back to actually those sermons, those sources. Is there anything back there that I could use? And I, of course, stumbled on the Beatitudes, and there they were, that list of those who mourn, those who are sad and heavy laden, right down to that most ominous one, the meek shall inherit the earth, which is always a bit of a downer to those of us who do not find meekness remotely in our And so when I tried to apply these to Mark, I was at a loss because I couldn't find him among them. And I thought, we need a rewrite here. We need another one. Because if, in fact, the meek shall inherit the earth, then surely the sweetly goofy shall endure. Because that's who he was to me. When I think of him, and like most of you, I think of him a lot, I smile. Whether he was proffering a little bouquet of his skewed point of view for just to distract us from the day's occupation, being backstage to congratulate a new member of the company who joined in, beaming at a performance in the back row, he always produced a smile. And I thought to myself, that's what he was for and what he wanted. It's not in this society an uncontestable gift, believe me. When you are lucky enough to participate in a miracle like Hairspray, you are bonded together. Maybe you're defined by it in a certain way. And those of us who have worked with each other before, during, afterward, if we knew how it happened, we could make it happen every time. So you search through the helix, through the DNA of what that is, to say, why did this work this way? And of course, as the laughter in this room indicates, the ineffable difference was Mark. Do you know anyone else who could have produced all of this? Or any of it? No, you don't. And so we have to console ourselves with that rewrite. That no matter what else may happen, he will, in fact, be with us because the sweetly goofy endure. And now, speaking of endurance, it is my great pleasure to bring to the stage one of the great prima mobile of the Hairspray dynamic and all of the members of that family that Mark Shaiman. Mr. Shaiman.
I would welcome members of the original cast and crew of Hairspray. Don't share a front door key. Stewart. Thank you. To make up for my voice, Darlene Love is going to sing in 2 minutes. So.
We're going to sing Mark's two favorite songs from Hairspray. It's a gift to him. The first one was his favorite song that was cut. So with the help of the foot mics, here it was a public service announcement on a recording comedy show. Blood on the pavement.
I know.
Doug Hughes, and I guess the privilege falls to me of bumming you all out. In 1976, the graduating Mark O'Donnell was chosen to write the class ode. His instructions were that the resulting lyric was to be sung to the tune of Fair Harvard. I have never forgotten one line of Mark's ode. Unspeakable youth, when we flirted with truth. Seven words, a compact, profoundly witty, purely rhymed, unflinching statement of the tragic view of life. It scanned perfectly, and it came unbelievably from the pen of someone I would now classify as a boy. It should not be forgotten, while I get all valedictory and elegiac and highfalutin here, that Mark was also the professional writer who could describe the purgatory by which a producer's or a publisher's payment of a piddling advance could condemn him to months, even years of inane and fruitless creative meetings as LTNPL, long-term no-pay limbo. He was also the guy who wrote the immortal line, "I saw Sigourney Weaver on the street today. I pity her." In the fall of 1975, I approached Mark, the most famous wit of my time at Harvard, with fear and trembling, and humbly asked that he might contribute a sketch or two to a review I was putting together for production in the glamorous Lowell House JCR. I genuflected at the altar of intimidating undergraduate genius and was met with kindness, enthusiasm, encouragement, and with that deluxe brand of charm that makes the recipient feel charmed. Our collegiate collaboration changed my life. The exemplary action of the loving, generous, and grateful way he went about his work in the theater set a standard for me. Decades later, on good days, I do my best to rise to it. I'd grown up around the theater, but working with Mark when we were both kids truly revealed to me why I loved it so. He spoke to me of the thrilling conspiracy of putting on a show. He taught me how to revel in the foxhole camaraderie shared by those who earn their living by getting laughs or telling tales. He was a great teacher, a masterful synthesizer. Throughout our friendship, I stood by awestruck as he translated chaos into order, connecting the dots between Looney Tunes and the Poetics, between Russian fairy tales and DC comics. He seemed to see into the immense design of things. How did he stand it? He went spelunking in secondhand bookshops and parking lot flea markets, treasure hunting for clues to the maddening, hilarious, and unanswerable riddle of it all. And he would bring us back sepia postcards, or Edwardian etiquette manuals, or kitschy figurines, or scratchy 78s recorded by justly forgotten crooners. And he would present them to us, and we would be baffled. Until we read the note that accompanied these artifacts, a ragged piece of spiral notebook paper with a few perfectly composed and compact lines in his slightly spooky, childish hand. And then we would be made to understand. These were signs. These were symbols. They were small portions of the meaning, the glory, the fun that the world was always yielding up. Didn't we see? We did. But only after he had seen it all for us. And that is how I feel about his work, that play of his I directed so many years ago. That's It, Folks, was a candy-colored book of revelation, a miracle play for our time, a work that made you feel swell about the fact that all things must pass. It was hilarious, and it was beautiful. That was a rare combination Mark was always striving to achieve. He succeeded very, very often. Our friend was an odd man, a wonderfully and irresistibly odd man, sweetly but fiercely defiant of all our prescriptions for us. He was always out in front, fearlessly paddling on his own underground river, while most of us stayed sensibly close to the surface. He never borrowed a shred of his own being from anybody else. In my last email message to him, written days before he died, I pissed and moaned about some trivial misfortune, some bearable drudgery, some minor disappointment. And then, citing a bit of patented O'Donnell uplift, I quoted him to himself to signify that my life wasn't all that bad. But no machetes, no malaria. So I guess I can go on. He replied nearly instantly. Thank you for quoting me. It justifies my being. All assembled here, and all who ever met him, know that his radiant being required no justification. I'm not a religious man, but I hope somehow he knows that now. He may have considered himself a stranger on Earth, but his visit to this planet was a triumphant one, staggeringly productive of laughter and joy, and of the awareness that we are, all of us, strangers on this earth, desperately in need of the connective tissue of laughter and theater and literature and friendship and love, all of which Mark so abundantly supplied.
Thank you.